Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to the Acteurist Oeuvre-view. We've reached the end of the 1950s with Lilli Palmer. We'll be discussing But Not For Me and Conspiracy of Hearts. We'll dive right into Leonard Maltin's TV Movies and Video Guide, 1991 edition. He gives it 3 stars out of a possible 4. Chic remake of Accent on Youth. Dealing with theatrical producer Gable, thwarting advances of young Secretary Baker, deciding sophisticated Palmer is more logically suitable. That's not exactly what happens in the movie. The director, Walter Lang, and the cast list: Clark Gable, Carroll Baker, Lilli Palmer, Barry Coe, Lee J. Cobb, and Thomas Gomez.
How would you describe exactly what happens in the movie?
Well, I just don't think that he fends off her advances. They kind of get into a bit of a relationship, which doesn't seem to be factored in by Maltin there. And he's crushed when it doesn't work out, momentarily.
Sort of.
Yeah.
Go into the reasons for that. They're not strictly due to his attachment to her.
No, of course not.
One of the very striking things about the movie is Clark Gable, first of all, giving a primarily comic performance.
He's an expert comedian. We've remarked on that quite a few times. In the late 50s, he had a couple of nice little flourishes of this kind of thing. There's this one and Teacher's Pet, fine film as well, with Doris Day.
There's also a striking lack of vanity in his portrayal.
I mean, the character has vanity and keeps claiming to be in his 40s.
So Clark Gable is 57 or 58 making this movie, which is also the character's age, as we find out toward the end. Initially, it seems like the movie is deciding that Carroll Baker isn't really interested in him, but then it turns out that she's more undecided, would you say?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of confused emotion in this film. It's not nearly as schematic as Maltin makes it seem.
It's not as bad as Ghost World for just deciding this May-December romance is completely non-viable.
No, because I think they have a pretty nice chemistry, and Carroll Baker's pretty sharp, so she doesn't come across as someone who's overmatched.
I love Carroll Baker.
Yeah, me too.
She's a great method-trained actress. Astonishingly beautiful, and yet somehow at the same time looks and sounds like a real person.
Well, I guess that's the method training. And this is not a super glammed up role for her, but she certainly had some of those. Or trashily glammed up in some cases as Baby Doll.
Well, yeah, I love Baby Doll, which is the movie that proves that Tennessee Williams is always writing black comedy. The movie gets meta right off the bat, and I mean, it is based on a play by Samson Raphaelson, frequent Ernst Lubitsch screenwriter, and it's commenting on, probably the original play had this idea, Gable and the playwright he's working with, when they get the idea of how to fix this play that has the young woman and the older man in it, very meta about what we're watching, right? The old man chases the young woman, audience is going to be sick. They say, but we can save this. It'll be acceptable if the young woman chases the man. And the way Gable delivers the line whitewashes the old guy completely. You know, it's hilarious. But also a timely moment to be remaking this property because there were so many extremely aging classical Hollywood leading men who were not being replaced and who were being used to introduce up-and-coming very young stars like Carroll Baker. And Audrey Hepburn, particularly particularly Audrey Hepburn.
Yeah, we've talked about this a little bit, but the late 50s was, I would say, the apogee of mismatched male-female pairings, right? You've got all these movies with Gable, Gary Cooper, Fred Astaire playing romantic love interests of, 20, 21-year-old women.
And this is a rare movie. I mean, in general, personally, I am for age difference relationships. I'm like, you want to do it? Do it. I've done it. Sure, it can work. Or it might not. There might be practical reasons for it not to. If the crazy kids can make it work out, great. It's the double standard that's the problem, right?
Yeah.
So on the one hand, I'm watching these two, and I feel like the movie is being very conservative in suggesting that this relationship is inappropriate, but really the more conservative and status quo opinion might have been, it's perfectly acceptable for a much older man. But it wasn't. It really wasn't. Audiences did accept it in huge hit movies, but 30, 40 year age differences in real life between older men and younger women aren't very common unless the man is extremely rich.
In those movies of the 50s, the audience is agreeing to pretend generally that the man isn't as old as he seems to be. And they're thinking about this leading man as if they're still what they were in the 30s,
but
often.
That's what makes this movie an interesting intervention, because it's commenting on exactly that and saying, no, we can't fool ourselves. Like that moment toward the end where Lilli Palmer is trying to destroy these delusions of the two of them, and brings the young Clark Gable photo, and Carroll Baker is looking at young Clark Gable and her photo of old Clark Gable and being like, oh god, they're not the same at all.
No.
And like, talk about lack of vanity that Clark Gable is participating in this.
I can certainly remember Frederick March having a scene like that in Best Years of Our Lives. He looks at a picture of himself as an actor from the 30s, and then you see the saggy-faced mid-1940s Frederick March, and he winces. But you sort of expect that kind of thing from Frederick March. Clark Gable, the king of Hollywood.
And it feels like, is this a good idea for him? But I don't know, did he just really feel like, personally, did he feel like, no, I can't pretend to be that person anymore?
Well, unfortunately, when he did try, even a little bit, it killed him, right? I mean, the Misfits, he did all that Mustang wrangling, and he dies because of that shoot. Heart attack, right? Which is not far in the future from this.
No. So maybe he was right that he should have been slowing down his speed.
Probably for the best.
Anyway, it's a charming, fun, smart, late performance by Clark Gable. Worth it even just for that. But of course, there's also the wonderful Carroll Baker and the wonderful Lilli Palmer.
Let's get into Lilli Palmer, since she's the reason we have the film on the schedule. She's playing the ex-Mrs. Ward.
Yeah, speaking of double standards, of course, Lilli Palmer, we keep seeing her looking absolutely fantastic for her age. Clearly still, well, very youthful for her age, and also clearly still very desirable. You could also have someone look in her age and be desirable, but she's doing both. Yet having to play the role of a woman whose husband of the same age or older is, in this case, not straying, but she's competing with a much, much younger woman.
They've been divorced for many years already when we meet them, and they've reached a kind of amicable, bantering friendship stage in their divorce.
But it's clear from the beginning, where she gives him this divorce anniversary present that plays their song, which seems to be a reference to Shop Around the Corner, but the cigarette case that plays their song, he's going to be annoyed all day long by listening to their song.
Could be. Samson Raffleson was involved in that too.
It seems clear that right from the get-go that she wants back into this relationship, but not on the terms that they were on. And of course, all these types of roles always feel like they have a real life referent, commenting on, I don't know, how much did the, well, of course the public knew that Rex Harrison was cheating on his wife. I don't know how much they knew beyond that one scandal, but that was probably enough.
That scandal was more than enough, I would say. The Carol Landis public was aware she'd had marital difficulties in the past.
Right. And it's another, yet another role where she does what I have identified as one of her specialties ever since that marriage, which is extreme ironic distance here in a comedic mode.
Oh yeah, of course. It's a big part of her arsenal at this time. However, she is far cry from the character that she played in Les Amants de Montparnasse, because she is not trying to set the world on fire, basically, and destroy everyone. I mean, she seems to genuinely like Carroll Baker, even though she's doing her best to kid her out of this infatuation with her ex-husband.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's interesting to think of how many different things she can do with that mode, right? That she can play a character who is cruel and bitter and sort of sadomasochistic, or play a character who's ultimately very wise and tender in this movie.
She's behind everything good that happens in this movie. It turns out that she's been hoarding her alimony checks to secretly finance Clark Gable's comeback play.
She's almost like a more benevolent Walter Burns. Well, she's finding ways to keep herself professionally in her husband's life.
Oh yeah, well, she entertains on Long Island. She's got Thomas Gomez playing a studio mogul she just happens to have around in case Gable needs to try to drum up some funds pre-selling the movie rights. They're still a team, even though they're divorced.
What we learn in that very funny scene, too, after Carol Baker's character, who is an aspiring actress, Ellie Brown, when she gives the performance of the character based on her.
And I mean really based on her, because all of the dialogue is snatched from her mouth.
What we see is what Lilli Palmer's character later says, which is talent is the thing that matters to her the most. And we learned that she was an actress. I can't remember how much detail we get about that. Do we understand that she gave up her career when she married him?
She doesn't say that, but she doesn't seem to be acting anymore. She did say that he was always gallivanting off and she had nothing to do. So yeah,
exactly.
It does make it sound like she retired
so
when
she was
got
in,
married.
She was in Carol Baker's position, you know, a young woman, young actress being wooed by this producer. Then at a certain point, we don't know why. We don't know anything about children. No children are mentioned, but she did give that up. But obviously still, as we see here, involves herself in the profession, in the wifely way, so familiar from this time, kind of in an informal role of being critic and offering her acute judgment, also socializing and facilitating these business deals. But yeah, so this is the basis on which we believe that their partnership ought to ultimately work out, when we discover that there's something that she puts above her jealousy, right? That the two of them can share. And that she's not into being a petty rival of one retired actress to new up-and-coming actress.
No.
She's willing to be a mentor, right? Even for someone who is a romantic rival.
And she becomes a very important mentor. It does seem like if she hadn't intervened, Carroll Baker's star would never have ascended to the firmament. I mean, the first tryout doesn't go well, and we don't get too much of a sense of how this magnificent makeover occurs, but we see the beginnings of the scene where Lilli Palmer settles in to give her some pointers that are gonna activate her talent in a way that the audience can appreciate.
So yes, so her role is to, which is so well suited to Lilli Palmer's persona, her role is to be an ironist and to puncture their delusions with her irony.
Now, one of my favorite scenes is the Central Park scene, which I always remembered in the years after I first saw it. It's got echoes of things like The Lady Eve, right? Where this is a scene that Clark Gable has lived before with a different woman, or in this case, really a different woman. And like in The Lady Eve, he makes some smart remarks that turn out to be echoes of the exact same dialogue he had used with Lilli Palmer, and she shows up to share the bench with them in the snowy Central Park scene, and things get rather crowded. This does cast a little bit of a pall upon this romantic moment between them, but she doesn't do it in nearly as vicious a way as she could have. She's just very bemused by all of it.
Well, no, her goal is always to break this up and move in herself.
Yeah.
And it should be unsympathetic, except that, as with Walter Burns, ultimately you know that this is the thing that's best for him, and that's best for them.
Right, but it's pretty different from Walter Burns, because nobody wants...
Well, she is a trickster like him, but he's a much darker trickster figure.
The person he's playing the tricks on, Ralph Bellamy, I mean, is really a bad idea for Hilda Johnson. And
well, I think we are supposed to believe that this marriage wouldn't work, but more importantly, that it would be, that the marriage to Lilli Palmer would be much better if he can be properly educated.
Yeah, of course, of course. But I just think it plays differently when you've got someone that isn't a caricature as the third point of the triangle.
Sure.
It just makes the movie more sophisticated in that way, about romance. Maybe not more sophisticated in the comedy scripting or whatever, but it veers on taking the easy way out, but then it does interesting things at unexpected points. I always liked the way the movie ends, because it seems to be parodying the kind of scene that we've witnessed many times before, and maybe offering a kind of critique of what had happened to the Lilli Palmer character, right? Because as we feel, anyway, by watching this, it seems like she gave up her career, and Carroll Baker's not going to do that. It seems like, okay, well, if Gable winds up with Lilli Palmer, then this other guy, Barry Coe, is just gonna drag Carroll Baker off to Idaho, like bus stop or something. Right? I mean, that's clearly what those scenes are asking audiences of the time to think about. He's like a man-child who's just decided that's it, taking you off to big sky country and no one's ever going to hear from you again. And she absolutely refuses to go along with that. And it's an ironclad condition of them continuing with the marriage that they hastily jumped into, that they have to stay in New York and keep acting.
But don't you think this is part of Clark Gable's education, that he has to step in and say to the young man, look, don't do this.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, for three quarters of the movie, at the very least, you may or may not think that, well, I think you mostly do not, simply because of the self-irony that Clark Gable is using. You mostly think, no, this relationship couldn't possibly work out, but you do believe that Carroll Baker really is in love with him. And then toward the end, like, and all of Lilli Palmer's tricks are directed toward showing Carroll Baker that this man that she is idealizing is not like that. And quite apart from their age difference, he can't make her happy.
Right.
Right?
But you get those scenes, like the best scene between Clark Gable and Carroll Baker for me is the one where he barges into her apartment and her ex-boyfriend is passed out on her bed and they start to have a fight and then it gets diffused really quickly. And it's really a wonderful segue into showing you the kind of rapport that they could develop, or they're threatening to develop here, like a better understanding of each other. If you're cheering for Lilli Palmer, you're like, oh, this is not seeming so good.
No, but then he has a conversation with the young man and challenges him.
Yeah.
Says, I am so certain that Carroll Baker really loves me that you can throw all of my faults in her face and it won't matter, right? And this is where he is set up for a gentle, luckily gentle fall that completes his education. Well, it doesn't complete it, because it, like we said, it goes on, but begins, maybe, his education, right? Where suddenly she becomes confused and realizes, well, partly through Lilli Palmer's doing, partly through her young boyfriend's doing, starts to wonder how much of this is love and how much of it is just infatuation, and how much of it has to do with the figure that he cuts. And this is interesting, I guess, as a sort of mild inquiry into patriarchy and why young women do become attracted to older men. It's not because they're sexy. It's because, you know, the man has power and position and accomplishments and the glamour of all of that. And that is
the phallus of the Senex figure.
Oh, dear. The phallus of the Senex? Is that going to be our episode subtitle? And the movie kind of almost says this as well. Well, does say this. Is it the boyfriend who says this toward the end? Once Carroll Baker has some of that phallus for herself after her success, he's not looking as good anymore.
Yeah.
That maybe that is, maybe what she wanted was the Lacanian phallus all along, or the Freudian phallus, or whatever phallus applies.
Yeah, here. He's like, well, yeah, he's the old star maker, but now you're a star. You don't need to be made anymore by Clark Gable, right?
And whether it's because she's a different kind of person, or because she is of a new generation, or because she's not really in love with Clark Gable, that does make a difference to her that it didn't make to Lilli Palmer. Like, Lilli Palmer isn't so happy about the way her life ended up, but she loves him regardless.
Yeah, and that's revealed fairly early on. I mean, it seems kind of clear from their bantering interaction that there's still something there, obviously, but things get more emotionally revealing when she has her talk with Lee J. Cobb, the alcoholic playwright that is having so much trouble getting this thing slapped together, until Clark Gable brings in the script doctor, Carroll Baker.
The scene where momentarily Carroll Baker decides that definitely she isn't really in love with Clark Gable. You see him in front of our eyes. You see him. It's almost like Heaven Can Wait. The scene where the roué.
Oh, yeah.
Realizes that he's no longer young, he's no longer desirable. But Clark Gable is such a good actor, and he really sells this lightly, and yet you can still feel the depth of it for him. He just says goodbye to his youth, because there is also a sense in which it's true that just as Carroll Baker has wanted the phallus from him, so he has been trying to retain or recapture his youth. Like, I actually felt a little, almost teary.
Yeah, every nuance of that pain is there on Gable.
And yet he recovers just as quickly. He realizes he has some self-awareness about it, right?
Yeah, but he does go into a little drunken spiral.
Well, yeah, afterwards. He has some self-awareness before and after the drunken spiral, which we don't actually see.
That is a real lack of vanity. I mean, he looks fucking terrible in those scenes. I mean, he looks worse than he did when he was locked up in solitary in Strange Cargo.
If this movie isn't Gable himself having some catharsis about the end of his stardom period, the filmmakers certainly make you believe it could be.
Right, and while we've talked about in our Hollywood Studios Year by Year series, Joel W. Findler demoted Gable from 3 stars to 1 star after World War II, and he's been toiling away at the 1-star level, according to Findler. Anyway.
Even though I was looking at it again online, and the last time he had been, maybe it's only once in the 50s that he gets into the top 10 box office, but he had been in the top 10 again in 1955. I don't know what he made that year.
But yeah, I like Gable in the 50s. I just like Gable all the time. He's a great actor who doesn't, you know, despite the incredible fame, and we've talked about this many times, I don't think that he gets nearly his due as an actor.
Yeah, and there's none of the early tough guy stuff at all in this movie either.
No. He's playing more in the huckster's vein here, I would say, which is a great movie and great performance.
He is maybe to a point of unbelievability. He never seems, like, sexual attraction never seems to be very important in his relationship with Carroll Baker.
Well, he's just been around young, beautiful women like that every minute for the past 40 years. She doesn't stand out in that way, but she does wind up standing out in the intensity of desire that she projects, at least for a while. That's what catches his attention. First, as a way to fix the play, and then as a way possibly to fix his life.
Well, yeah, I mean, for a long time, he actually is using her to fix his play, and then he seems to be sort of keeping her sweet as a star. And of course, you hear all the stories about Hollywood directors who slept with their female stars just in order to keep them sweet for the movie and turn in a good performance, right? Well, he doesn't do that, though, but he is flirting with her for that purpose. She kind of wears him down, and he starts thinking about, maybe this is a possibility, maybe this would be a good thing, why not?
Yeah, and the movie encourages you to entertain that notion, but always keeping the great Lilli Palmer right there for you to cheer for as well. I feel like it ultimately, you know, it's not a surprise the way things go, but it doesn't play up the contrast as much as it could have between the two possibilities. It's a really fun movie. It's not one of the greatest movies of all time, but it's got that Perlberg Seton quality to it. They made just a lot of New York movies, those guys. And usually George Seton directs Acteurist's movies that they produced, but in this case it's Walter Lang. They made The Country Girl, they made Miracle on 34th Street, just a lot of authentic New York feel to this movie, and wonderful introduction to the film that I always liked. I watched it sometimes just for the beginning because you get to hear Ella Fitzgerald singing, but not for me. Just a beautiful entrance into this world of the New York theater.
The screenwriter wrote Rear Window,
a main Hitchcock collaborator in the 50s.
So that's not shabby, and I just feel like it is. It's a very smart screenplay. It's a fantastic cast, and even though you know what the outcome is going to be, it does allow itself to complicate matters, to get a little bit complex.
Yeah, it just sort of tantalizes you with that possibility. Well, maybe they could find a way to get this to work out, even though we know that that's not the way this movie is designed.
And maybe they could, but he has a better option. The things that these two characters want from each other, and that wouldn't necessarily be uncommon for an older man, younger woman relationship, isn't necessarily love.
If things don't work out between Carroll Baker and Barry Coe, I mean, she's not stuck in Idaho. She can just divorce him anytime she wants, as long as they stay in New York and she keeps acting in the theater.
Which he agrees.
Yeah.
To do.
Under duress.
Yeah.
So he doesn't get much agency at all, but that's fine. Because he's the least important, least likable character in the movie.
She does pull an Audrey Horne.
That's true. Sneaking into bed and taking her clothes off to create a scene. Yeah. Maybe David Lynch watched this movie.
Or maybe that's just a common, mildly pornographic fantasy about older men being pursued by younger women. So, conspiracy of hearts?
Leonard Maltin does indeed have this movie in his guide. He gives it 3 stars out of a possible 4. Despite familiar situation of nuns sheltering refugee Jewish youths in northern Italy.
Is that a familiar situation? Are there a bunch of movies about that?
Well, nuns versus Nazis, I guess, has happened before, but...
In The Sound of Music.
This film manages to be suspenseful and moving. Directed by Ralph Thomas and the cast, Lilli Palmer, Sylvia Sims, Yvonne Mitchell, Ronald Lewis, although there are a lot of other people in this movie. It's a big cast. George Koulouris is in it, playing the pig farmer. And the most important person that doesn't appear on that cast list is Albert Leven, who was Lilli Palmer's leading man in Beware of Pity, and here he plays Nazi commandant.
So Dave, what are your impressions, I'd like to begin with, of the movie's politics?
There's certainly a lot of talk about Italian partisans who were fighting long before the demise of Mussolini. I mean, it could have some socialist resonances there.
And of course, there's also the idea of the Italian soldiers not accepting the German occupation or the German authority.
It's a very complicated situation there that the film gets into in an interesting way.
But also, what occurred to me while watching it is that this is not a movie that has any kind of religious viewpoint, that religion is being used here specifically as a form of highly committed liberal humanism, even to the point of Catholicism and Judaism coexisting in the same space.
Sure, although some of the nuns express confusion.
We're not siding with them.
No,
we're siding
not.
With Lilli Palmer, who is the voice of liberal humanism here, but as a religious cause to be devoted to, and I think that that is subtly pretty unusual, this religious universalism, maybe not as much in a British film as it would be in an American film, but still, it's striking. Well, Dave, it therefore did not surprise me to find out that both the original story, which became a teleplay, which aired as an episode of Goodyear Playhouse, and the screenplay were both written by blacklisted writers using fronts.
Yeah, well, I just saw Adrian Scott.
Yes, and Robert Presnell Jr., the screenwriter, was acting as a front for Dalton Trumbo.
Ah, okay. Definitely discern a critique of authority that is much more wide-ranging than pure anti-Nazi cant.
And a unique use of religion.
I think people making this, at least, maybe not many of the people watching it, would have been familiar with Rome Open City, a meditation on this very same time period, and shows Catholic clergy at the lower strata of the church, very politically engaged in a way that contradicts what the Pope and the bishops were doing at the time. The Catholic hierarchy does not have a good record during the fascist period.
Well, sure, yes, the political involvement, but more strikingly to me is the idea of no one particular religion, and especially not Christianity, having the truth of God locked down.
Right, well, don't forget, this is a British film. I mean, Catholicism would not be the religion practiced by most people in Britain, and would not be thought of as, this is our religion anyway. So the nuns are othered as well.
But they're modeling something.
Yeah, definitely.
And consciously, self-consciously modeling it under the leadership of Lilli Palmer's character, the Mother Superior.
Of course, we know that Lilli Palmer herself was, in fact, Jewish, but here she's playing a Catholic, leading other Catholics who don't really know much about Judaism and are discovering details about a culture that, you know, they've been pretty ignorant of. They don't know what Yom Kippur is, for instance.
But they've got that book in their library that's going to tell them. It's like Giles's library in the Buffy High School. The movie starts out seeming like a familiar story, right? Nuns and kids, nuns and kids, nuns gonna help the kids, and the adorable, huge-eyed, little starved waifs do feel a little bit treacly at certain points.
Well, it gets pretty far away from what you'd typically expect when there's biting.
True, and when children are calling themselves
dogs. Yeah, I mean, it gets a little bit more intensely into the dehumanization that these children have experience than a typical film of this kind would.
Still, if you squint, it's all pretty cute, other than mass death. And mass death becomes a very important educational moment in this film, the reality of that sinking in for these nuns, particularly the more skeptical nun who becomes a convert to this humanist cause. But the movie works its way up to, for me, a veritable orgy of emotion, where the nuns, let's not think of them as nuns, because you could have a melodrama, a political melodrama set in a Canadian colonial setting where the Catholic nuns are the Nazis. Let's think of them as liberal humanist heroes disguised as nuns. Like, they're superheroes, basically. And the movie is very effective, I find, in the way it, you have to understand it in the terms of melodrama, where ultimately these nuns are just, even though we see the flaws of their flaws and their doubts, right? And their biases, their prejudices. By the end, it's just a confrontation between good and evil, and you have to go with that. And the movie, for me, gets a lot of mileage out of, as someone who is not religious in any orthodox sense at all, socialist writers, for me, they reshape the idea of what religious desecration is by showing these scenes of slaughter in the midst of peaceful religious ritual, particularly the murder of the rabbi.
Well, yeah, that's a pretty hard to watch scene. This guy shows up certainly superhero too. He sneaks over the wall and says, you know, since I joined the partisans, I never come in the front door.
No, he's so charming.
Yeah.
Right?
Such a welcome sight and providing so much to these kids who've been deprived. I mean, especially the oldest kid who has some real memories of what life would have been like before the concentration camp experience began.
Well, speaking of Canadian colonialism and the role that nuns played in that, in residential schools, it's like these children, in addition to being starved and everyone they know being killed, all of their relatives being killed, they have also been torn away from their culture and made to be ashamed of it,
mm-hmm.
of their identity, right? So yeah, so that is what Lilli Palmer's mother, Catherine, gets the inspiration that they need to do this too for the children, not just give them food.
And wait until the time is right. That's a pretty incredible scene when they lay out this feast and nobody can eat because it's Yom Kippur.
Well, it's literally man cannot live by bread alone, right?
Yeah. The resurrection of an entire culture and microcosm here by allowing that to happen, to bring out the food after sundown when it's right to eat.
But of course, all of this dramaturgically, all of this is arranged for us to be concerned that a massacre of the innocents is going to take place right in the midst of this cultural recreation, right?
Yeah, and committed by people that are not committed to it. right? And again, this is the banality of evil. I mean, Albert Leven gives an amazing performance
movie. Let's go back to the beginning and talk about all of that, like his introduction.
We're at the period of the war where Italians have overthrown and killed Mussolini and opted out of the Axis, but that does not mean that the Germans are going to go anywhere. They're protecting the southern coasts of Europe by hanging on to Italy. There's been a complete change in the power structures, and we see a rescue on basically the last night where the apathetic Italian garrison is looking the other way, consciously, we find out, to allow at least the children in this concentration camp to escape. And the nuns are working in a symbiotic relationship.
Yeah, there. It's not made explicit, but each side knows what the other is doing.
Once the Germans decide, okay, well, we're not allies anymore here, we're going to install ourselves as the commandants at all of these camps and garrisons. And I mean, things really start out with a bang with Schultz, is that his name? Yelling at everybody. The Italian major who had been running the camp is like, do you have to be so loud?
Schmidt.
Yeah, Schmidt. But the actual new head of the camp is Albert Leven, a cultured, civilized man who does not find himself to be in sympathy at all with Nazi politics and says it really has nothing to do with anything. I'm a Wehrmacht officer and I follow orders.
It's interesting because I'm just looking at when Hannah Arendt's Eichmann in Jerusalem was published, and it was published in 1963. I don't know if it appeared in any other form before that, because this is the same idea, as you were saying, the banality of evil, right? People have said that she was wrong, that he was in fact lying when he said he wasn't a committed Nazi. But the idea still stands, and presumably there were many real representatives of it among the Nazi officials.
There would have to be, right? Or among, anyway, not maybe not among the Nazi officials, but among the officers in the army that was prosecuting the war.
I don't know the distinction.
Well, Nazis were party members, right? So presumably they did hold these ideas. And in the 50s, you know, we had the movies that almost make a hero out of Rommel, right? The German tank commander, the noble enemy. And this is pulling back from that and saying, well, this is what your real noble enemy was, who was a highly placed officer in the German army during World War II. You know, if you're going to celebrate their professionalism, well, that's what a professional does in an army. They implement orders from above. And when he is told, do not let any more prisoners escape, that's what he intends to do, even though he doesn't agree with imprisoning these kids in the first place. It's not his job to reason out.
The way Leven plays it, it's very decadent, right? The way he moves from saying, oh, I'm tired of the question myself. But nevertheless, he just moves on to whatever he's going to say next. So it's interesting the way that he not only is this figure of the banality of evil, but he's also self-conscious about it, and he's using it as a way to ingratiate himself with and get the cooperation of
Major Spalletti,
by saying, well, I'm neither one of these Nazis nor one of these idiot true believers among the rank and file. I'm a rational man, like you, I'm just going along with this, right?
Well, what he is passionate about
is, it turns out, is military order.
Absolutely, and crushing partisans. Right? And that's the real game here. The interest for him certainly isn't in, okay, do children get away or not? Yeah, he doesn't care about that. He's not interested really in imprisoning the children. But the people that are helping the children to get out are socialist partisans in the countryside, and he wants them, definitely. And that's what he's been sent there to do. And so it really becomes irrelevant, you know, who the rescuees are.
We've seen versions of this before in other socialist wartime occupation movies. What was that one about the rebel fighters in Scandinavia?
Oh, Edge of Darkness. Warner Brothers movie by Lewis Millstone.
Right, which also had socialist leanings. And so what we see here is, having watched that movie, I could see where this one was heading, which is that Horsten seems like a rational man who can get what he wants through rationality, but his system of thinking forces himself, like creates this blind spot where he's forced into, for for the sake of consistency, forced into executing nuns and cannot see how that is going to create this rebellion. The people that they're occupying are not going to stand for this.
Yeah, ultimately, there is, we hope anyway, a breaking point in what people will stand.
Executing nuns who were rescuing children turns out to be it.
Yeah, because they do go along with executing poor George Coloris.
The garbage truck guy.
Yeah, who makes a crack about Goering and lives, but not very long, to regret it.
But that's, you know, already got people primed to be pissed off. They're not going to take much more of this.
Right, well, Major Spalletti almost turns there.
And again, this is educational. This isn't necessarily, although perhaps this did happen in real life cases, in historical cases, this isn't necessarily psychological, it's educational, it's modeling, it's saying, you the citizens have got to have a breaking point where you won't stand for evil anymore.
Okay, well, sure, but also you the soldiers should not be following orders, well, and that goes back to the French Revolution.
I was including soldiers and citizens, but I shouldn't have been. So all of that's going on, and it does the nun's moral stance, which is not rooted in Catholic chauvinism.
No, definitely not.
The nun's moral stance does lead up into this orgy of emotion. But we see along the way how the skeptical nun, I mean, I guess that's the most important trajectory, right, for the characters inside the convent. How the skeptical nun,
Yvonne Mitchell, Sister Goethe.
Sister Goethe has this moral awakening, so she is voicing...
Well, she says, yeah, the hierarchy won't like the way we're behaving.
And we're breaking the law, she says, yeah. But also, so there's fear. We know she's being motivated by fear, but also she's voicing skepticism against this, frankly, very non-Christian and very non-Catholic liberal humanism, which is what the Mother Superior is actually practicing, right? This socialist humanism, whatever way you want to look at it. Liberal is a dirty word. And universalism, right? And she's right. Like, from the standpoint of a practicing, believing Catholic, she's absolutely right to be suspicious of this. But Mother Catherine puts her in charge of this traumatized little girl. Well, they're all traumatized, but she seems to be particularly so. I suppose hoping that that will melt her heart, but it doesn't, because the girl just keeps biting her.
And they have to bring in Sylvia Sims to soothe her.
But oh, I guess the first wave of emotional orgy occurs when Sister Goethe has her breaking point, which is during the Yom Kippur ceremony, when they have these children tell them to write down in cards the names of loved ones that they've lost,
so that a prayer can be uttered for them.
And endless, endless, endless relatives are listed. I mean, obviously the weight of that finally makes her realize what's been committed to these people.
Yeah, it's a pretty impactful scene.
And that is familiar from the genre of nun movie, and I do love a nun movie. The one who is the most hardened. We even see this in Song of Bernadette, right? The one who is the most hardened, once she can be convinced, once she has her conversion, becomes one of the most dedicated to the cause.
And willing to offer herself up to be decimated, right? Because that's the punishment that Albert Leven proposes, since you're all guilty. I'm not going to shoot all the nuns. I'm going to kill one of every 10.
And the young and tender nun, with the novice, with whom Lilli Palmer has had a discussion about whether she should even be there at all because she's in love with Major Spalletti, but he's too worldly for her, so she's gone to escape from him.
She thinks that he's been complicit in, and I mean, he has been, he's an Italian officer who's been running this garrison, and she was not aware, as some of the more highly placed nuns knew, that he was allowing the children to escape.
Right. She tries to offer herself because she is as pure-hearted as she is beautiful, but Sister Goethe and Mother Catherine won't allow that. And Sister Goethe understands that she does have something to atone for. So does Mother Catherine, who is responsible for this happening to her convent as their leader, and as someone who's been very actively persuading them to do this, and taking them down all sorts of strange paths, like arranging for Jewish rituals to be performed in the convent.
And having hidden passages behind paintings.
Who even knows what purposes those once served? Nobody gets into that. And then an older nun offers herself, reasonably. But of course, there's the pathos of age being tortured. There's also a momentary flare-up of pornography, Nazi nun pornography, when the beautiful young nun is going to get stripped and flogged.
Yeah, not a pleasant prospect.
Which, reminiscent of our discussion of the inherent sadomasochism of proto-Nazism in Mädchen in Uniform.
Right.
A military discipline and pornography go hand in hand.
Yeah, well, they rip her veil off, and that is enough to create the shock. She's got her Joan of Arc hair.
Well, yeah, you have to get rid of your vain hair, I guess, when you become a novice. And then Spalletti offers to save them all by committing murder, so that's a further moral nuance.
And they have an ethical discussion about that. Unbeknownst to them, Albert Leben is listening on the other side of the door. Lilli Palmer insists that she doesn't want to be party to any kind of plan where she's in on the fact that the soldiers are going to kill the Germans.
Right, she's being Captain Kirk and he's being Spock. Yeah, she's saying he reasons, well, but I can save the children too. Don't you want to save the children? And she's like, maybe God will save the children, but my belief system is such that I can't, it's not instrumentalism.
No, it's a deontological ethics for Lilli Palmer all the way, and she never does go along with any plan to kill Nazis, but it happens nevertheless.
It's very satisfying. So God does decide to save the children and kill some Nazis.
And she wasn't privy to the plan, so I guess she can feel okay about it too. She probably doesn't feel that bad about Albert Leben and Schmidt getting killed.
Although she does say a prayer.
It's always a great scene when soldiers who are ordered to do something vicious turn around and do the humane thing.
Well, of course, it is always a great scene. And the movie makes great use of some great moral emotional trope. And of course, when the nuns are being lined up to kill, don't you hear in your head the speech, the young drummer's speech from Dishonored?
Yeah.
Right? I will not kill any more women. I will not kill anyone, or however it goes. But
should we zero in a little bit more on Lilli Palmer as Mother Catherine?
So this is very different from her detached, ironic roles, benevolent or not.
She gets a chance to flex a little irony and iciness when confronting Albert Leben.
Well, she has to have authority.
She's got a little bit of playfulness there too, and she seems to be sparring with him a little bit at times. And he accords her much more respect than you would imagine someone in his position would, because she happens to have been a German aristocrat before taking the veil.
Right, and she pretends that she's unhappy that's been revealed, but of course she is happy because that will distract him.
Yeah, definitely works in her favor.
I think her aloofness, though, is very useful in this role. You have to believe that this woman has this practical and moral authority and is eccentric.
Very eccentric. I mean, this wouldn't be happening without her. That's clear. No matter how well-meaning these nuns are, someone needs to organize them, and she's the one to do it. The priest, as well, is not the motivating factor here. It's really her.
She's like the leader of a sect. She's like someone who has broken away from her supposed religion and had a new visionary insight, which turns out to be socialist humanism.
Yeah.
And she keeps getting involved in these roles. This is drawing on her ability to play absolute goodness, as in Mädchen in Uniform, charismatic goodness, right? And we've seen decade after decade her getting involved in these films with strong ties to socialism. Like, it seems hard to believe that she didn't pretty early on start choosing her roles carefully, as soon as she was able to. We'll see if she continues to have good roles to choose from, but these two movies are both very good, and Conspiracy of Hearts is a very interesting movie.
What did we know about Betty E. Box, the producer? Was she related to Muriel Box?
She was related to Muriel Box's husband.
Oh, okay.
When he assumed control of Gainsborough Pictures, he named her head of production.
That's Betty Box. Okay.
So Sydney Box was involved in giving women some very prominent roles in British cinema. And yeah, she was a motivating force behind it. And she was making a very popular series of doctor films.
Oh, the Dirk Bogarde doctor movies? Yes,
which, just reading the brief discussion of them on the page of Conspiracy of Hearts, kind of makes me want to see them. They were massively popular, and it was the popularity of these films that allowed her to make this pet project, which, however, turned out to be very popular as well.
Interesting. I've never actually seen the doctor movies, but they've been on my list. They get talked about a lot as a fun series, and obviously Dirk Bogarde's always great. You don't get to see him having fun that often
in the movies. That's true. He's usually pretty grim.
And tortured, yeah. And this movie has some really nice light moments in it, which you wouldn't expect mixed in with the orgy of emotion. But yeah, it does kind of lull you into thinking maybe everything's going to be okay and no one's going to get killed for the first half.
And then sometimes it lulls you into thinking that everyone's going to get killed.
Yeah, and of course the breaking point there is when the first nun is shot. And this is where Lilli Palmer has to confront, you know, the consequences of her decision. She's okay with it ultimately, but she's not unscathed by, as no leader should be. I mean, she got this nun killed and she owns that. But on the other hand, what else are they supposed to do? That's her only argument, really. Do I protect my nuns from getting killed, or do we stop these children from getting killed? There are no good choices here. But it does feel like she made the right one.
She says more than one time, I think, that in her interpretation, this is the only way they can follow their vocation.
Right. Which is to help people.
Yeah.
Seems reasonable to me.
And to not stand for evil. Of course, hearing a line like that makes me think, and perhaps the socialist writers wanted me to think, about how we all stand for evil all day long, every day. We are all Spalletti.
I like Spalletti as well. Ronald Lewis, not an actor I know. Everyone was really good in this movie.
A Welsh actor. Yeah, he had he just had a nice quality of believable weariness together with youth. And yes, finally manages to get morally motivated by the end, well, when his girlfriend is threatened, but also when he realizes, as he says during that scene, that Torsten is not a reasonable man.
No.
And they cannot work together.
It's a very nicely judged performance by Albert Leven, and that's not a surprise. I was impressed by his performance in Beware of Pity. I've always liked his small role in Life and Death of Colonel Blimp.
Why do you think he thinks that the nuns will talk?
I think he thinks anyone will talk if they're put under enough pressure.
Yeah, I mean, we have to assume again that that's another one of his blind spots. Spalletti says right away, and we believe him, more tension could have been wrung out of whether the nuns will talk. But since Sister Goethe has already been converted to the good cause, like, she is the one that you would primarily be worried about talking.
Yeah, there's no weak link there.
Yeah, there's no weak link left.
Schmidt does get a chance to brutally interrogate the priest.
Right.
Which is a rough scene to watch as well.
Well, that's what I mean. Again, that's probably the other moment, along with the murder of the rabbi on his altar. The other moment is the beating up of this priest. Right, that restages and gives a new meaning to a secular but still moral meaning to religious desecration.
Yeah.
It's just wrong. But what we're seeing here is just absolute wrongness.
Yeah, so that definitely harkens back to Rome Open City.
Maybe I'm able to accept that kind of moral melodrama better when it's presented with these almost cartoonish, broad stroke, familiar tropes.
I guess that's going to do it for Lilli Palmer this week, but two more interesting choices. We'll have to see what the 60s bring. Next week on the podcast, it's Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 20th Century Fox. We've got some very interesting movies for you. The Razor's Edge and The Dark Corner. So a major novel adaptation and a Henry Hathaway film noir.
Sounds good.
See you then.